Are you in the process of building a UX or UI design portfolio? In this video, we'll give you some expert advice so you can properly structure your portfolio so it stands out to hiring managers. This video is a snippet from one of our recent live events, where Kim Steindel, one of CareerFoundry mentors, details some of the key elements you need to consider when building out your UX or UI design portfolio. If you're interested in more events like this, check out our event page on our website. And if you think UX and UI design might be for you, check out one of our short courses in these areas. The links are in the description below. Now, let's dive in to find out what you need to structure your UX or UI design portfolio.
Let's talk about the structure now. I already talked a little bit about that you can basically do whatever you want and that everything can be successful. It just needs to be in context with the company. But there are a few areas that we should implement in every portfolio, because just by crunching numbers and just by looking at case studies and heat maps, these things are most looked at and most effective. So let's talk about these. The very first thing is a hero image. For those who don't know, a hero image is basically the very first picture you see when you click on a case study on a website. It's different for every single one, but a lot of case studies don't have one, which is a shame. They just start right away with a problem statement or anything else. But the hero image is the first thing a recruiter sees as well, and it shows your design skills. So you should typically feature some high-fidelity wireframes on your hero image, and the best way to do that is also to feature them on multiple devices. If you only feature mobile screens, but you want to work for companies that have both mobile and desktop or maybe iPad design requirements, then a recruiter might look at this, see mobile screens all over the place, and they are thinking, okay, cool, they can do mobile, but can they stop? I don't know, right? And sometimes they don't have the capacity to really look at this or the knowledge. So a hero image is important. Every case study should have an hero image, and every case study should ideally include different devices so that they know how the designs look at. Next point, summary. You need to describe very early on what your project is all about. The things that you need to describe here, or the best things that you can describe here, is the problem you're trying to solve with the app, right? Why does this app exist, or why does this case study exist? But also what you used and what you did in order to tackle this case study. So as a recruiter, I have a bullet point list. I know that there are terms on it, and I can see A and B testing. I can see high fidelity prototyping. I can see customer journey mapping or user stories, right? And I need to find these as quickly as possible because I have 200 other applications to go through today, and I can't spend 35 minutes on a single portfolio trying to find all of these keywords. So we want them to see these keywords very early on, because then they have a peace of mind and they won't read the rest anyway because they don't understand it. So they can spend the rest of the time looking at pictures. So if they find their keywords right away and then look at the pictures and they like the pictures, the chance of you getting the interview is really, really high. Next thing, consistency. Especially when case studies are a little bit longer, it's really easy to have them inconsistent. We introduce new colors. Maybe we did our customer journey map in a different color than our user stories. Maybe we are using different fonts. Maybe we are using 10 or 12 different font sizes for different headlines. That seems like a minor thing, but it makes the case study look very chaotic. For example, if you have content that is left aligned for the first part of the case study, and then content that is middle or right aligned for the rest of the case study, maybe not everyone will be able to call out that this is an issue, but it may leave a feeling of, hey, this doesn't look right. So consistency is really important. Also, when it comes to the language usage, I see a lot of people starting off with language usage in the present. I'm going to, and then they are switching to I did, or they're using in another past tense, right? So if you create something, it needs to be consistent. Fourth point, quality. the main selling point of your portfolio will be the content that you feature. So whenever you feature high fidelity wireframes or graphs, user flows, or anything else that could have high value, the picture quality should be of high resolution. Your screens can be the best looking screens that the world has ever seen, and you won't get an interview if they look blurry. Usually what I found most effective in terms of size, because you don't want them to be too big, because then the website never loads. But the most effective thing in terms of size is downloading them in 4x. So if you're in a design tool and you want to feature something, 4x is a great way to do that. Next ones, high fidelity. High fidelity screens perform better if they are found early on. That's why we also put them in the hero image and at the end of the case study. We know this because we tested it with heat maps. So a heat map is a tool that shows you where visitors, what visitors do on your website, right? So you can see where they glance over, you can see where they spend the most time, you can see where they have their mouse, where they click. And usually we find that whenever we have high fidelity screens, that there is the most attention. So always feature, if possible, high fidelity screens. Now, that doesn't mean that you can't apply if you don't have them yet. There is still a lot of great jobs given to people without high fidelity screens because the company didn't need it. But if your project can benefit from it, then this will be a great way of pimping it up. Next thing, language. Project-based language beats the personal learning language. Especially when people are new and a career switcher, they don't want to, well, maybe they do want to, but often the language that I'm seeing from people is more like personally focused, personally learning focused, and not so much focused on the project. It's more about, I did user UX studies. I did high fidelity wireframing. But it would be better if you describe the project itself, because then you can also give the context, which is the last point. So instead, you should be writing, high fidelity wireframes were created to establish a prototype that could be used for user testing. A user persona was created in order to combine all the needs and questions we got from interviews, right? So always try to have it more project related than personal related. Next point, GIFs and videos. Moving images and small videos are the best thing ever as a recruiter, because sometimes you're really bored going through these case studies because it's a chore, especially if you're not a designer yourself. It's not something that you like doing. But if you have some GIFs and videos, often your attention is exactly there. It's fun to look at, and not enough people are doing it. You will find that a lot of great portfolios that are being featured in top 10 or top 15 lists, one common nominator between almost all of them is moving images or videos in some way or form. And we also know through heat maps, again, that this is very successful. Last thing, context. Since every business has their own expectation of designers and their own roadmap and their own goals and wishes and pain points, we should always try to give them the context of our thinking. Part of your first interview rounds will always be trying to understand your design decisions, because otherwise it's too easy to say yes or no if you disagree or agree with something. For example, if you say, I did user journeys and customer journey maps, but the company has never heard of that or they never considered doing it, then they may look at this and may say, well, this is not relevant for our job. But if we give them the context, we are telling them why we did these things, even if they are not doing it, even if they don't like it, even if they don't have any budget for it, they can still understand why it was relevant for that different part of your case study. And it will really help them to understand your thinking as a designer, which in return makes it easier to invite you for an interview. So these 8 points are absolutely something that you should implement when you have the chance, because it will skyrocket your chances of getting to the first interview stage.
So I hope you enjoyed watching this webinar snippet. If you have any questions about structuring your UX or UI design portfolio, let us know in the comments. Also, let us know what was your main takeaway from this video. If you want to see more design events like this, check out our events page on careerfoundry.com. Subscribe to our YouTube channel for more weekly videos like this. Thanks so much for watching. See you next time.